Okay, well, thank you, John. So John put me on the program for mating disruption, but I thought I'd also just give people a heads up that we are in a cicada year. So I'm gonna be talking about both those topics and just giving you an overview on where we stand with those. So let's start with the cicada. It's been a long time since we've had a bigger emergence of the cicada. And so 2021, we're gonna get an emergence of brood 10 of the periodical cicada. This is a 17-year cicada. So the last time it came out was, if I'm doing my math right, 2004. And this one hits north central Kentucky through northwestern Kentucky. So up along the Ohio River counties, but just not those counties next to the river. It goes further into the state than that, but it's across that northern stretch of the state, generally between or west of Cincinnati. But there are a few counties down in southeastern Kentucky that can get a little bit of that, but it's going to be pretty light in those southeastern counties. We do have several other emergences that are going to occur this decade. So brood 19 is coming out in 2024. So that's going to be in the Penny Ryle and Green River areas and some lighter numbers in the Purchase. That is actually one of the 13-year broods. But then in 2025, we're going to have brood 14. And this is the biggest of our cicada broods in the state and hits most all of the state except some areas in the Purchase. So that's a big one, and that's going to affect a lot of fruit growers throughout the state. And then as getting towards the end of the decade, we have brood one. And again, that's just going to be in some southeastern Kentucky counties. So that's not as much of a statewide issue at all. You can see with the images down there, you know, the progression. So you get the nymphs that are going to come out of the ground. You know, that first night they emerge as adults. After a few weeks, you can see that female, she's laying eggs. And then on the left or on the right there, you can see the damage they cause to these stems. And so really the damage is to those pencil sized stems. They tear in there with their egg layer, their ovipositor, and really weaken those stems. And that's where you get stem breakage. We call it flagging, where it still hangs in the tree, but it's dead. And we can get quite a bit of that. So what we're looking at is, you know, emergence usually occurs sometime in May. This is generally about 2 months ahead of the dog day cicada that comes out every year. So the periodical cicada comes out earlier. You recognize it because it's black with the red outlined wings. Normally they have red eyes. That's actually, the picture there is a blue-eyed variant. And they stay active into May, and it's really towards that second half of their activity that you start to see the egg laying damage. What they're particularly affecting are young trees. You know, if you're setting out new trees this spring, they're going to have a lot of those pencil-sized limbs that you're going to want to grow into scaffold limbs, and these are particularly susceptible to the cicada laying damage and breakage, and you end up losing some of those initial scaffold limbs. And so, you know, knowing this in advance, you know, you may want to delay setting out new trees in a bad cicada year. Otherwise, if you are setting out some, you really want to monitor them and treat for cicadas if needed. The people that are going to be higher risk to periodical cicada will be people who have orchards that are close to wooded areas. The cicadas don't travel very far in their lifetime. It's, you know, on the order of, you know, a couple hundred yards. So, you know, if you're in close proximity to wooded areas that have cicadas, you're at higher risk. If your orchard's a long way from those areas, it's a new orchard, you're at much lower risk. Like I said, egg laying begins a few weeks after the initial emergence. You're gonna know if you have cicadas in the trees because you're gonna hear them during the day. You get that droning that occurs while the adults are active. Now, in terms of control, I did some spray evaluations with a previous brood and found that the pyrethroid sprays are the best for controlling cicadas. That's the Iraq Group 3A. You see that on the label. You definitely want to use a pyrethroid that's labeled for apples or peaches or pears or whichever trees you're trying to protect. Now, generally, I'm not a huge fan of using pyrethroids in orchards just because they're so tough on mite predators. And what we've seen in the past is you can flare mite problems using pyrethroids. But it's one of these things where I think it's more important to prevent the damage, and then we'll deal with the mite issues later. You really need to prevent that egg laying damage. And you know, a number of growers have used the pyrethroids, got great control with cicadas. They may have to use a miticide, or they may use some oil sprays, that's how they keep their mites under control. But anyway, I just wanted to alert you that we are in a cicada year. No, it's not going to affect everyone. In fact, this brood, it seems to be shrinking in size a little bit in terms of the area in Kentucky where they emerge. So the next thing I wanted to talk about was mating disruption. We've been using mating disruption for a number of years. I've used it at our research farm in the past. We have a commercial grower that's been using it for several years. What mating disruption does is it targets a particular species and a particular species of moth. And what we do is we put up dispensers that release the pheromone. And this is a synthetic copy of the pheromone that the female produces to attract male moths at night. Generally, for example, with coddling moth, they mate sometime, you know, after midnight. That's typical to until about 3 a.m. And they release chemicals at night. They bring the moths to them and they get mated, and then they can lay eggs, and you know, the cycle continues. So what we do with mating disruption is we flood the orchard with synthetic versions of that chemical. And so the males, not only can they not find the females because everything seems to be emitting that chemical, but they also become desensitized to that. They don't respond to that chemical anymore. And so we just prevent the females from becoming mated. They do not get their eggs fertilized. So even if they do lay eggs, those are unfertilized eggs that won't hatch. And so this is a strategy. We use it with many, many different types of moths. It's very specific. So each particular species has their own particular combination of chemicals that they use to communicate, where the females will attract the males. And so when we have mating disruption, it's often for a single species, and you know, it's very effective. This is the basis for the area-wide management of coddling moth in the Pacific Northwest. And so that they're doing area-wide, so not just individual farms, but you know, regions where they're reducing the coddling moth populations with this technique. So some of the limitations with this, you know, it sounds great, but there are some limitations with this. One of the first limitations is it needs to be done over a relatively large area. So what we're talking about is 5 acres or more, basically 5 acre blocks or more. So this is not something you do on your backyard trees, or if you know you have 100 trees, something like that. No, it's not going to work, or it's not going to work very well. So you need to do it over large areas. And the reason for that is if you have a very large area, you're less likely to be affected by females that have been mated outside of the area moving in to your trees. It's just a much larger area, and so there's less perimeter. So that's why they have that 5 acre limitation. Now, if you had, you know, 4 acres of trees and that's all you have, well, you can still do mating disruption over 5 acres. You can do it for over your block in an area outside of the block, and that's fine as well. But you do need that large area. One of the other limitations is that if you have had serious coddling moth problems the previous year, you know, going to mating disruption the next year, it may not give you the level of control that you want. You really want to get the population knocked down some, and then it's going to keep it at that area. And so the first year we use mating disruption in an orchard, we're using it generally in combination with an insecticide program, and or at least an insecticide program around the perimeter of the field. So, and again, that's going to suppress that population. The second year, you can rely much more heavily on the control provided by the mating disruption. The other thing we have to do when we use mating disruption is, you know, when you go out in the orchard, there's no way you can determine just by looking at the orchard if the mating disruption is working. And so what we do is we put up pheromone traps for the pests that we're trying to disrupt their mating, and we hang those in the trees. And as long as the traps are not catching any of that species, we feel very confident that the mating disruption is working. And so what they recommend with coddling moth, for example, is using some of the high release rate, extended longevity pheromone traps for coddling moth. And so we put those up in the orchard. We change the lures as needed. We change the liners on the trap, you know, when they get cluttered with debris. And that's how we know that the mating disruption is working. So there's a number of different options that are available for mating disruption with coddling moth. So what we've used in the past has been dispensers that we put in the trees. Generally, these dispensers were used at rates of 200 to 400 dispensers per acre. More recently, they've come out with dispensers that you don't have to put out 200 or 400, but it's less than 50 dispensers per acre that are used. There's also sprayable formulations. These are microencapsulated sprays, so they slowly release the chemicals over time, and these can last 120 days or more. And probably the most recent have been these puffers. This is actually technology that was developed from fuel injection in engines, and they're using a similar technique to release the coddling moth pheromone at night. They're programmed. They release the pheromone between, I think it's 5 in the afternoon until 3 in the morning, because that's when you need it in the trees. And you don't have to put up as many. You put 1 to 3 per acre. And these last for the season as well. So you can see that the technology is advancing. So from 2017 through 2020, we worked with the Kentucky Hort Society, Pacific Biocontrol, and Nutrien in Indiana, Stuart Brenneman, to get a product registered. I think Cindy Finiseth was talking about how it's difficult to get some of these products registered in Kentucky. Well, this is one where the company would submit the application and then a third party would pay the fee for the state. And I would help to coordinate that and we would get the product registered. And we had that for 2017 through 2020. And the product we were selecting was the Isomate CM Flex. You can see what it looks like in the picture. It took 200 to 400 dispensers per acre. These are placed in the upper third of the tree. With all these different technologies, they're always placed in the upper third of the tree. One strategy was also to increase the number of dispensers on the edge of the orchard, particularly if you're surrounded by areas where you think the coddling moths may be moving in from. And we had to place these prior to coddling moth emergence, so prior to the first flight of the coddling moth. So they go out very early. It was a season-long technology. It's still available, and it worked very well. The problem was it was difficult getting that registration lined up each year and coordinating with the third party and getting the Kentucky Department of Agriculture, knowing that an application is going to come from one source, a payment's going to come from another source, and getting all that coordinated. So this year, it's a little bit different. We have a new product. It's called Sidetrack CMDA plus OFM MISO. So that's the name of the product. It's really coded. The name's really a code. CM, you know, coddling moth. DA stands for dual action. And the reason is they actually have chemicals in there that are not only going to affect the mating of the moths, but it also affects the female moths. And then the OFM is Oriental fruit moth. And so now we have a product that's not only doing the traditional mating disruption, it's also affecting the female moths, and it's getting two species, the coddling moth and the Oriental fruit moth. And, you know, I've done a lot of trapping in orchards over the years. We have some orchards where coddling moth is the primary pest causing the worm in the center of the apple. Other orchards where Oriental fruit moth is the worm that's getting down to the center of the apple. And then some orchards where they have both those. But these are causing the worms in the apples. Now, with this new product, the company that's producing it, Trace, is paying the annual registration. So they went ahead and they took care of the annual registration. The reason why I asked them about this is a lot of growers in Indiana are going to this new product. And so, for example, Nutrien in Indiana is going to have this product available, and Trace was willing to register it for Kentucky. Now, just like the other product that we had in the past, these need to be placed in the trees prior to the first flight of both species. And keep in mind that OFM moth activity occurs a little bit earlier than coddling moth activity. It provides 180 days of control. So if you put it out, say for example, today, you would get control through mid-September. So that's pretty good. Unlike the 200 to 400 dispensers per acre, you only need to put out 32 to 36 dispensers per acre. So right there, it's a big reduction in labor with this. Again, just like the others, these dispensers need to be evenly spaced throughout the orchard. They need to be placed in the upper third of the tree. You may want to increase the number of dispensers, particularly around the perimeter of the orchard. Now, they're used in combination with the coddling moth, the high-dose L2 lures. The company that markets it recommends the Delta trap. I'll show that to you in a second. And you also have to use a second trap, the OFM combo dual Delta trap. And so And you can see how often you need to change the lures on the slide. So with the coddling moth, with that lure, it's a 12-week switching out the lures. And with the OFM, the Oriental fruit moth, it's 8-week. One thing I didn't put on the slide, but I'd like to mention is you do need to use some gloves when you handle these. And again, you probably think, well, I'm thinking about your safety. Well, that's true. I am thinking about your safety, but also we want to keep other scents and smells off these dispensers. And so we don't want to interfere with how well they attract things. And certain scents that you can put onto these dispensers can actually interfere with mating disruption. So do ask people to wear gloves when they handle these and handle the pheromone lures in the traps as well. So if you're planning on using this, I would recommend phasing out insecticides over a season. Don't just switch to mating disruption. So I would still use some insecticides, at least one for each generation of these pests. Again, I did mention handling the dispensers with gloves. At the end of the season, what do you do with those used dispensers? You're free to just toss them in the trash at the end of the season. In terms of where to find them, I think the best is going to be Nutrien with Stuart Brenneman up in Zionsville, Indiana. I know he'll be carrying that. There may be others, but at least he'll have that. So the other thing I just wanted to mention was just general insect trapping. As long as we're talking about mating disruption, I do strongly recommend mating disruption. In apples, I recommend running coddling moth and oriental fruit moth traps. Even if you're using insecticides, it allows us to use the insecticides more efficiently and more effectively. In peaches, I recommend oriental fruit moth, lesser peach tree borer, and peach tree borer. These are the traps I would recommend. We need to get these traps up before first moth flight. You can see some different trap designs. What I have in the upper right there, that's the automated trap from DTN. What it does is, again, it uses a lure, brings the moth into the trap. They get stuck on a card in the bottom of the trap. And it takes a picture of the bottom every morning, and it has an artificial intelligence program to identify the moths, and it sends you an email every morning saying how many moths of that species it captured. So there is an automated one. The traditional wing trap, that white one down there in the bottom right, and then a lot of companies are moving towards this delta trap, and that's what that looks like, that orange one. By itself. So we put those up before moth flight. We change lures generally on a 4-week basis. What I do, because I run so many traps, is that I set them up at the beginning of a month. And I know the first time I visit a trap in a new month, I change all the lures. The liners need to be changed periodically, particularly after petal fall. You'll find the petals will get all stuck in there. When they become fouled, they're not going to capture other insects. So you need to change those periodically as needed. What we do when we use traps is we get a biofix date. And a biofix is very important because it helps us schedule that insecticide application. It does two things. One, it schedules that, also tells us if there's enough of the moths in the orchard where we have to do something, if it makes economic sense. So with coddling moth, we use the fifth moth in the spring for the biofix. During the season, if we get 5 coddling moths per week, we know we are gonna need to spray. With oriental fruit moth, it's a little bit higher. It's the 7th moth in the spring, or 7 per week. With the peach tree borer and lesser peach tree borer, we identify the peak flights, and then we spray 7 to 10 days later. So how you use that biofix date is with some models we have on the Ag Weather site. If you go to the insect models, you see there's models for a number of different pests. So for example, with coddling moth, if I caught my fifth moth on April 20th, I would get into that program. I would indicate where I was in the state and that the biofix was April 20th. And then it would tell me when it would be time to spray. Basically, I would look for, depending upon the product I'm using, probably 250 what they call degree days. And that would be the optimal time for spraying. So we have that for coddling moth. We also have that for oriental fruit moth. Again, if you have any questions, give me a call. I can walk you through some of this, but this is how we time our sprays and determine whether or not we need to spray. With coddling moth, we have three generations per year. We're in part of the country where they're not well synchronized. I'll show you a graph in a second. Oriental fruit moth, we have six or seven generations per year, but they are well synchronized. Peach tree borer, one generation, and lesser peach tree borer, two generations. So this just shows you a graph with coddling moth. This is from, I think, 2010. And this was out in the purchase area in Graves County. And, you know, we don't have three distinct generations. It looks like a relief map of the Rocky Mountains almost. And so we use these traps. We check them every week, and we come up with our counts. And you can see how these counts relate to that five moths per week threshold that we have. This was actually a study where we're looking at the trapping and using new chemistry as opposed to the standard spray schedule with the old organophosphate insecticides. So this strategy definitely does work. And this shows oriental fruit moth. And this is some data from the late James Bennett. He would check his trap every day. And it shows you what it looks like when you have a very synchronized pest where they were coming out just over a few days with each generation. So this is how we use that, and this is how we would schedule those insecticide applications.